I always like to say that a genome is the instruction book to make a living thing. And every living thing on Earth, whether it's me, whether it's you, whether it's a tree, whether it's a bacterium, even things that aren't really living like viruses, they all have a genome. They have this very simple instruction book written in four letters that says, this is how you make a living thing. And just like we can read a book, we can read genomes too. And it turns out that, you know, just like books in the world are all sort of subtly different from each other, genomes out there are subtly different from each other. You know, one version, one edition of a book might be slightly different from the previous edition. We can look for those tiny changes and use them to describe the relationships between bacteria, between viruses. How I like to explain my work is using the analogy of the kids' game telephone. So in the telephone game, kids will be sat in a line, somebody will whisper a sentence to the first kid, they whisper it to the next kid, who whispers it to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next. Sentence reaches the end of the line, kid at the end says what they heard, person who whispered the sentence to the first kid in the line says what they inoculated that line with, and everybody laughs because it's different. The sentence has mutated as it spread from kid to kid to kid. The same thing is happening with a pathogen's genome as it spreads from person to person, moves forward through time in an outbreak. So what we're doing with our work is really just reading the genome of each of those pathogens. We're sort of asking the kids, you know, what sentence did you hear? What did you hear? What did you hear? And we're saying, okay, well, in what order were those kids sitting in? The order that a change, you know, arises in and is passed down to kids further down the line, we can use that information to figure out exactly the order they were sitting in. We do the same thing with pathogen genomes, only in this case, instead of a sentence, we're reading something that's the equivalent length of the book War and Peace, if we're doing a typical bacterial genome. And over the course of that entire outbreak, many you've got, you know, 20 kids sitting in a line reading War and Peace to each other 20 times, only, you know, 15, 20 letters in that entire book might change. But that's enough. That's enough for us to be able to figure out the order of transmission.
We've been trying to tell one bacterium from another one for a long time, and we've been using different methods. I mean, for decades we've been doing this. We'll start with, you know, molecules on the surface of the cells, or what color it is, or what shape it is, and we've been refining that methodology literally for decades. And every time we come up with a new methodology, we pretty much had to throw away all the data. Now, with genome sequencing, there's no further resolution we can really go. If tomorrow we have a better DNA sequencer, the data is still the same. It's just that we can do it faster and cheaper. And so the databases that we're building, like Genome Tracker, the databases that we're building to track foodborne pathogens, will stay the same. We don't have to throw it all away. So genome analysis gives us a forward compatible database that is immortal.